I don't want any more anything, period.
So I'm gonna say, wanna go shopping?
Good morning.
Good morning.
We've gathered to honor Dorothy and Robert Hayes. We've gathered for three reasons. First, we come to remember and celebrate the life of Dorothy and Robert Hayes. Secondly, we come to help each other in the time of grief. And finally, we gather to remind ourselves of the promise that those who put their hope and trust in Jesus will live even after they die. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn on with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love which we hold one another. In all ways we trust you, and to you with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the first 8 verses in Eugene Peterson's paraphrase reads like this. For instance, we know that when these bodies of ours are taken down like tents and folded away, they will be replaced by resurrection bodies in heaven, God made, not handmade, and we'll never have to relocate our tents again. Sometimes we can hardly wait to move, and so we cry out in frustration. Compared to what's coming, living conditions around here seem like a stopover in an unfinished shack, and we're tired of it. We've been given a glimpse of the real thing, our true home, our resurrection bodies. The Spirit of God whets our appetite by giving us a taste of what's ahead. He puts a little heaven in our hearts so that we'll never settle for less. That's why we live with such good cheer. You won't see us drooping our heads or dragging our feet. Cramped conditions here don't get us down. They only remind us of the spacious living conditions ahead. It's what we trust in but don't yet see that keeps us going. You suppose a few ruts in the road or rocks in the path are going to stop us? When the time comes, we'll be plenty ready to exchange exile for homecoming. If we think about the goodness of God, we'll listen to the song, How Great Thou Art.
Consider all the sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Dorothy Hayes, age 91, passed away on March 24th, 2020 at Messiah Valley Hospice. I messed it up, Chuck.
Messiah.
Valley Hospice in Las Cruces, New Mexico. She was born September 14th, 1928 in La Harpe, Illinois, to Clarence and Belle Rosita Cassingham, Knee Laws. Dorothy completed nurse's training at Galesburg Cottage Hospital School of Nursing in 1949, an internship in 1950 at Michael Reese in Chicago, where she met Bob. She and Robert L. Hayes were married June 10, 1951. Dorothy worked in professional nursing for 45 years in healthcare and industrial nursing in suburban Chicago. She and Bob retired and moved to Las Cruces in 1990. After retirement, Dorothy became an avid traveler, having visited most of the world, including the Middle East, Australia, Europe, Asia, the Far East, and South America. She enjoyed and was an expert cook, interior decorator, and quilter. Dorothy was a benefactor of the Spencer Theater for the Performing Arts in Reduso and was a regular attendee. She was fondly remembered for her caring, kind, ongoing nature, which blended intelligence, determination, high moral standards, friendship, humor, and love. Preceding her in death was husband Bob, 2003, and sister Shirley Poston in 1996. Robert Lewis Hayes, age 77, passed away November 10, 2003, at Mountain View Regional Medical Center in Las Cruces, New Mexico. Born April the 19th, 1926 to Robert D. and Mary Hayes, Knee Chamberlain, in Danville, Illinois, Bob served honorably in the U.S. Navy during World War II as an electronics technician mate and earned his B.S. degree from the University of Illinois and master's degree from IIT in chemical engineering. He was employed by North Shore Gas, Union Starch, DCA, and lastly, 29 years at Corn Products Corporation. During his tenure at CPC, he was responsible for developing novel processes, engineering of corn agriculture products, commercial examples of which are Mazola and Argo Starch, among others. The last 12 years of his time at CPC were spent as a corporate engineer with responsibility for the construction and startup of new corn processing facilities globally. Bob traveled the free world during his time at CPC. He retired in 1990. Bob is remembered for his extraordinary intelligence, forthrightness, strong opinions, sharp, insightful wit, and wiry sense of humor. Preceding him in death, sister Dorothy Hansen, 2012, and brother William, 2000. Dorothy and Bob are survived by their two sons, Robert Hayes, Roberta Watson, and Charles and wife Mary Ann Hayes. Other survivors are grandchildren Carrie Stephen Bruns, Kristen Heather Moreland, Theodore Hayes, and Rebecca Huff, Brian, great-grandchildren Ashlyn, Amanda, Emily, and Caitlin. This time, Kristen is going to come and share some memories.
Good we are gone, release us, let us go. We have so many things to see and do. You mustn't tie yourself to us with too many tears. But be thankful we have so many good years. We gave you our love, and you can only guess how much you've given us in happiness. We thank you for the love that you have shown, but now it is time we traveled on alone. So grieve us for a while, if you must, then your grief be comfort by trust. That it is only for a while that we must part, so treasure the memories within your heart. We won't be far away, for life goes on, and if you need us, call us and we will come. Though you can't see or touch us, we will be near. And if you listen with your heart, you'll hear all our love around you, soft and clear. And then when you come this way alone, we will greet you with a smile and a welcome home. This is from me. I'd like to think that welcome home for my grandparents would include a wonderful meal. I would request that they make their homemade spaghetti and meatballs. That was one of my favorite meals they made. If you ever got a chance to try it, consider yourself lucky. It was a recipe my grandma got from her Italian girlfriend around 1950. Making that sauce was an all-day event and quite a labor of love. My grandparents were excellent cooks. They enjoyed collecting and trying new recipes, whether it be from family, friends, travels around the world, or the frugal gourmet, which I hear was on at their house quite a bit, PBS. It was sure to be an excellent meal. My grandpa put together a cookbook of all their favorite recipes and gave it to my parents and Chuck and Mary Ann, and my parents made me a copy, so I'm glad to have that. And I was looking through it the other day, and at the bottom of all the recipes, my grandpa put in different notes about where they got it from, or maybe things they had changed to it, to the recipe, to suit their tastes. But growing up, we had many meals at their house, in Hinsdale mostly. Most holidays, birthdays, there were barbecues during the summer. And I remember this one drawer in the kitchen. It had this like metal liner, which I guess is a bread drawer, but there was always Oreos and Fig Newtons in there, so that was always a treat. It was very hard to go in there and maybe sneak one because that little drawer was noisy. Anyways, but I got to try many different and interesting meals at my grandparents. Yes, there were times as a young kid that these meals maybe seemed not so appetizing to my young palate. We always had to try no thank you helping, or else you got the stink eye from what we called Grumpa. But I would now say that I would call it a yes, thank you helping. I thank my grandparents for giving me the opportunity to try so many different and interesting foods. My grandparents were not always the most openly affectionate people, but I feel their way of showing affection was through their love of food and cooking such wonderful meals for their family and friends. Thanks, Grandma and Grandpa.
And yes, Kristen, I like spaghetti. That sounds good. Marianne wants to share with us.
Thank you, Reverend. The music which Chuck put together for the celebration contains two versions of the following Shaker hymn, which I feel truly expresses the core values of Bob and Dorothy. The hymn is called Simple Gifts and was written in 1848 by Joseph Brackett. The Shakers were a religious sect which broke away from the Quakers in England in 1747. In 1774, they settled in the United States and had communities in our Northeast area. Each community was self-sustaining, which means that they grew their own food, raised sheep for wool to make clothing, built their own furniture, etc. Bob loved the simple style of the Shaker furniture and built tables for their home, one of which we were lucky enough to have. As I thought about Dad and Mom, the overriding emotions were love and friendship and their belief in communication. Simple Gifts speaks to the value of these. Every Sunday, the phone would ring, and you knew you were in for 1 to 1.5 hours of stories. Mom, in the last few years, would share stories, which, as the conversation went on, would go further into her past. Usually, she would end up as a child on the farm here in La Hargue. The house is west of town, and south on the same road is Pastor Unger's church. Across from this church is where Bob and Dorothy were married, which was the Durham Church at that time, I believe, and is now a township building. Simple gifts. 'Tis the gift to be simple. 'Tis the gift to be free. 'Tis the gift to come down where we ought to be. And when we find ourselves in the place just right, 'twill be in the valley of love and delight. 'Tis the gift to be loved, and that love to return. 'Tis the gift to be taught, and a richer gift to learn. And when we expect of others what we try to live each day, then we'll all live together and learn to say. When true simplicity is gained, to bow and to bend, we shan't be ashamed. To turn will be our delight. Till the turning, we come round right. 'Tis the gift to have friends, and a true friend to be. 'Tis the gift to think of others, not to only think of me. And when we hear what others really think and really feel, then we'll all live together with a love that is real. Bob and Dorothy's gifts of love and friendship have been felt by all who have come to celebrate their lives today. It's a testament to them that we have family and friends here from Colorado, New Mexico, Missouri, Wisconsin, Illinois, and Michigan. I think we were supposed to have somebody from Michigan. Thank you for joining in our celebration of their lives.
Mary Ann, as you talked about the stories on Sunday, I couldn't help but think about what I read recently, that facts speak to our head, but stories speak to our heart. And that's the reason why we remember the stories. Chuck?
Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. I want to say thank you for coming to celebrate our parents' lives. And an extra special thanks to those of you who have traveled a long ways, Roberta, Stan, and Paula. But the fact is that when you come to visit La Hargue, you have to travel a long way. I think it takes everybody at least 3 hours to get here, you know. So I'm going to take some time to bore you and talk about my folks. Hopefully stir some nice memories of them. And, you know, I'll start by reminding you that my parents were born in 1926 and 1928. And this, is, of course, was before the Great Depression. You know, they were raised in the 30s, which was a tough time in history. The Depression wasn't a one-year event. It lasted basically until the U.S. got involved in World War II. So I want you to think about what things were like then. Didn't have any television. Talking movies had just been invented. And depending on where you lived, maybe you didn't have running water. Maybe you didn't have electricity. Maybe you didn't have a car. Now, Ford's current model then was the Model T. It was introduced after my mother was born. I'm going to take a break for a second here. Now, not everyone from that time can be characterized the same way, but I like to refer to my folks as having what I call the Depression era mentality. Now, this is not a negative thing. It's a huge positive thing. Because thanks to their parents' upbringing, our folks were smart, they were hardworking, they were economical, they were resourceful, and they had a great appreciation for what they had because they earned it. Not much was given to them other than the chance to be successful and work at it. Now, as many of you know, Mom came from a humble beginnings right here in La Hargue. She was raised on a farm west of town. You can still drive past the house, it's still there. But it's on a gravel road. She had a natural ease about her, a kind of a charisma, a perceptiveness, a genuineness, and she had the unique ability to hold a conversation with anybody. She was really good at it, and it's something that I strive for. Her father, Clarence, farmed using a team of horses to plow the fields. And I don't think it was until sometime in the 30s that he got a tractor. So he farmed using horses, 80 acres, plowing fields. His hands were permanently deformed. His two small fingers were deformed from holding the reins on a team of horses. But it made those fingers awfully strong because my mom told stories about him being able to break a shot glass by sticking his small fingers inside and break them. So mom made the transition from farm girl to rural traveler during her life, and that's a huge contrast in lifestyles. And it's really a testament to our folks' determination to be successful. She taught me a lot of practical things such as cooking, gardening, and so on. But from the less tactile, what I learned was emotional intelligence. Empathy, humor, love, friendship, all the life skills that you need to be a person that can relate to others. So I'm going to tell a little funny story about her. And if you find it funny, please do laugh. Now, I remember back in the 60s and 70s, we regularly used to get solicitation calls from companies that were doing remodeling projects and things like that. And one that called fairly often was pitching aluminum soffits and fascias. And mom had kind of gotten her fill of this. So one time the phone was ringing and she answers it. And you know, back then, you were pretty much obligated to answer the phone because you didn't have an answering machine, you didn't have caller ID or any of this stuff, so you picked up the phone. It could be a friend of yours, right? Well, mom answers the phone and she says with her quick wit, you know, it was one of these outfits trying to sell soffits and fascias and stuff like that. So she tells him, "Oh, well, we have a sod roof. Can you tell me how we're going to, how are you going to be able to install these? Could you tell me more about this?" Well, the phone was turned over to a supervisor who listened to mom and then started cussing at her, and mom hung up. But that was the kind of humor and intelligence that she possessed, and she was quick on her feet. And later she told dad, who got a good laugh about this as well. But you know, we were fortunate to have had her for 91 years, and at times she had health issues to deal with. But she recovered from them, and she was resilient, you know, she was. And as she said of herself, she was a tough old bird, you know. You can just imagine her saying that, right? We love and miss you, Mom. So I'm going to talk a few minutes about my dad, Bob. And he was a much more complex individual, put it that way. Because not only did he have the aforementioned Depression-era mentality, but he was also, from what has been coined, the greatest generation, having served in the Navy during World War II. And, you know, he was always interested in you and what you were doing. But he liked to test and challenge you. But most of the time he did it with a glimmer in his eye. But I really think he liked pushing people's buttons. He liked to test their limits, and he could be a real rebel in that sense. He strove for the highest levels in what he did, as anybody knows that knew him, and he expected that of you as well. So these were very high expectations, and you know, he was extremely smart. But you know, folks like to classify personalities as being type A or type B. Well, he was always a type A, but often was a type AA+. But, you know, if you could master understanding his personality, you could deal with anyone you might encounter. But little did he know, he was training me for my career in sales from a very young age. Now, that's not to say I have any regrets. I don't. On the contrary, I would not have traded the experience no matter how challenging it was. Some of the thoughts that come to mind when I think of Mom and Dad are all the things I learned from them. And this goes back to the comments I made earlier, and that's basically learn how to do things yourself. Be responsible, be diligent, be smart, educate yourself if you don't know how to do something. Tell the truth and do the right and logical thing. But saying it in a more succinct way, the basic principles are learn how to use your brain, learn how to problem solve, how to plan, and how to execute those plans. Make it happen. Now, from the practical aspect, I've learned how to fix everything around the house from my dad. I learned how to plumb. I know how to do electrical work. I know how to frame. I know about fine woodworking, auto mechanics. But I also learned the true value of money and how to invest it. Now, all of these things I've used during my lifetime. And I extend this teaching to others. Now, simplistically, you may ask, well, how did that help me? Well, it's obvious. But spelling it out, I help myself. I help my family. I help my friends. And we collectively improved our lives because of this. A sincere thanks to Dan, because I wouldn't know a lot of this stuff otherwise. I probably could figure it out, but he got me going. Now, as challenging as he could be, he had a very interesting sense of humor, and he could be very charming if he so chose. Now, the first time Marianne attended a big family dinner, this was before we were married, he told stories about when he was a kid. He told about stringing wire or maybe thin rope across alleys tied to trash cans. So at night when cars drove through the alley, he pulled the wire and then smashed into the side of the car, with I'm sure some fine words from the driver. Another story told of how an adult volunteer at a Boy Scout camp was bragging and was really proud of his new car. So Dad and some of the other scouts, maybe Stan was part of this, I don't know, maybe Bill, they took potatoes and they stuffed it in the exhaust pipe of this car. So that when later, when the guy tried to start the car, the potatoes blew out with a big bang, and I'm sure some more choice words from the driver. Now, after these two stories, Marianne jokingly told him he was a brat. Now, those of you who knew him can imagine how the air in the room got sucked out. Or, you know, everybody's like, well, boy, what's going to happen now? Well, he started laughing, and then the air in the room rushed back in. It was cool. But that was the kind of humor that described him in terms of, you know, how he thought about things. And, you know, he'd be really funny and kind, you know. He's been gone for 18 years, but I think of him, and I can only imagine how proud and happy he would be to see all of us today. We miss and love you, Dad. Thanks for taking the time to be with us. I hope I haven't bored you to tears.
Laughter, yes, tears, no.
Certainly not boring. We appreciate your comments, and it described a very interesting person. Psalm 23 is oftentimes read at funerals, and I'm going to make a little bit of a comment about it a little bit later on, but I want to share it with you. It simply goes like this. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. Surely my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. Now we're going to listen to a very well-known hymn, Amazing Grace. Chuck, I hope your father's sense of humor will appreciate the fact that I've never in my life ever used this particular passage of scripture for a funeral. But as I thought about someone as intelligent as Bob and someone as good at using her talents as Dorothy, the story about King Solomon asking for wisdom just popped into my mind. 1 Kings chapter 2, verses 10 through 12. So David slept with his fathers and was buried in the city of David. And the days that David reigned over Israel were 40 years. 7 years reigned he in Hebron, and 33 years he reigned in Jerusalem. Then Solomon sat upon the throne of David his father, and his kingdom was established greatly. Then we go to chapter 3, verses 3 through 14. And Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of David his father, only he sacrificed and burnt incense in high places. And the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for there was the great high place. 1,000 burnt offerings did Solomon offer upon that altar. And Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I shall give thee." And Solomon said, "Thou hast shown unto thy servant David my father great mercy, according as he walked before thee in truth and in righteousness, in an uprightness of heart with thee. And thou hast kept him for this great kindness, that thou hast given him a son to sit on his throne, as it is this day. And now, O Lord my God, thou hast made thy servant king instead of David my father, and I am but a little child. I know not how to go out or come in. And thy servant is in the midst of thy people, whom thou hast chosen, a great people that cannot be numbered nor counted for multitude. Give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, that I may discern between good and bad. For who is able to judge this thy so great a people?" And the speech pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. And God said unto him, "Because thou hast asked this thing, and hast not asked for thyself long life, neither hast thou asked riches for thyself, nor hast asked the life of thine enemies, but hast asked for thyself an understanding to discern the judgment. Behold, I have done according to thy words. Lo, I have given thee a wise and understanding heart, so that there was none like thee before thee, neither after thee shall any arise like unto thee. And I've also given thee what thou hast not asked, both riches and honor, so there shall be not anyone among the kings like unto thee all thy days. If thou wilt walk in my ways to keep my statutes and my commandments as my father David did walk, then I will lengthen thy days." As we remember the lives of Dorothy and Bob Hayes today, we reflect upon these two best loved and intelligent kings of Israel. Bob and Dorothy were both intelligent people, but like the two great kings of Israel, they also had wisdom, which is not an automatic extension of knowledge. So today we thank God for Dorothy and Bob, who were examples of wisdom. Dorothy was a very considerate, caring person who loved her family. Her outgoing personality made her a good company to be around. She did most things well, and everyone could see that she was a very classy lady. Of course, her family remembers the wonderful meals because Dorothy was a wonderful cook. We all need to eat to live, but sometimes when food is good, we're tempted to live to eat. Dorothy was a person who liked to do things well. Her culinary delights put fond memories into our minds. Bob was also very highly intelligent, had a bold, strong character, which we've heard much about today, that would possibly remind you of King Solomon, who had the privilege of building the temple for the Jewish nation. His reputation was known throughout the known world of his day. Bob, being ambitious and knowledgeable, was a man who got things done. Being a man of action, he got things done, which contributed greatly to his community and nation. We need movers and shakers like Robert to have a strong nation. He was also a man of detail. He was very exacting. You could depend upon him to get things done well and on time. He was a very demanding leader, but also held himself to the same high standard. Our country benefits from this type of dedication. So these two beloved kings of Israel remind me of Robert and Bob because they were loved by God and their people, because they were intelligent and strong leaders. God is the author of knowledge, and it honors God when we use what God has given us to our full potential. Both David and Solomon had families and experienced the love of family. You experienced the love of Bob and Dorothy. The love of mother and father helps us understand that God's love and that Jesus came to earth to make that love personal. We simply thank God for his amazing grace that allows us to be part of the family of God. Now we're going to listen to I'll Fly Away.
Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by.
Read the Shepherd Psalm, Psalm 23 earlier, and I want you to know that the message of that psalm is that God loves us no matter what. David wrote that at a time in his life when he was wondering if God still loved him because he had messed up. But when he came to the realization that God did, he went on to celebrate the fact that God was still his father and that he was loved by God. God loves you very much, and he's willing to forgive if you ask for forgiveness. I want to read something that Albert Schweitzer once said. It's not enough merely to exist. It's not enough to say I've earned enough to support my family. I do my work well. I'm a good father, husband, and churchgoer. That's all very well, but you must do something more. Seek always to do some good somewhere. Every man has to seek his own way to realize his true worth. You must give some time to your fellow man, even if it's a little thing. Do something for those who need help, something for which you get no pay, but the privilege of doing it. For remember, you don't live in a world all your own. Your brothers are here too. I want to close with this prayer of thanksgiving and ask you to join me in the Lord's Prayer using trespasses at the conclusion. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us, even to this day, for the gift of joy and days of health and strength, and for the gift of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends and for your baptism and place in the church, with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us as he taught us to pray. So now we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.